We know an ionic bond requires the transfer of electrons. One atom loses electrons and the other atom gains electrons. Now let's look at some of the conditions which are required for the formation of an ionic bond. The first is ionization potential. Ionization potential is the energy required to remove an electron from an atom. Now, we know in ionic bonds, one atom has to lose electrons, other atom has to gain electrons. So, one atom should have a very low ionization potential and the other atom should have a very high ionization potential. So, the two atoms should have a very large difference between the ionization potentials. So, if you look at the periodic table, we have taken a part of the periodic table. We'll see how ionization potential varies in a periodic table. From left to right in a period, the ionization potential increases. And from top to bottom in a group, the ionization potential decreases. The second condition required for the formation of an ionic bond is electron affinity. Electron affinity, from the name, it suggests the attraction for electrons. So this is the energy released when an electron is added to an atom. In ionic bond, one atom has to lose electrons, other atom has to gain electrons. So one atom should have a very low electron affinity and the other atom should have a very high electron affinity. Let's see what happens in a periodic table. So in a periodic table, let's see how it varies in a periodic table. So from left to right in a period, the electron affinity increases. And from top to bottom in a group, the electron affinity decreases. The third very important factor for the formation of an ionic bond is the difference in electronegativity. Electronegativity is the tendency to attract the shared pair of electrons. Again, in ionic compounds, we know one atom has to lose and other atom has to gain electrons. In order to do this, the two combining atoms should have a very large difference in their electronegativity. Let's see how electronegativity varies in a periodic table. From left to right in a period, the electronegativity increases. And from top to bottom in a group, the electronegativity decreases. So these are the three factors. The ionization potential should be very different. The electron affinity has to be very different. And also the electronegativity difference should be very large. Generally, the metals, they have a very low ionization potential. They have a low electron affinity and they have low electronegativity. They have they belong to groups 1, 2 and 13. And the non-metals, they have high ionization potential, high electron affinity and high electronegativity. They belong to groups 15, 16 and 17. So the type of compound formation between the metals and non-metals is ionic compound formation. An essential condition for the formation of electrovalent compounds is that there should be a large electronegativity difference between the two combining atoms. Is it true or false? So this essential condition, that is, there should be a very large electronegativity difference for the formation of an ionic compound. Ionic compound requires one atom to lose electrons, other atom to gain electrons. So the electronegativity difference between the two atoms should be very large. And hence, the given statement is true. Let's take an example. Let's take an atom, magnesium. So magnesium belongs to group 2. It has an electronic configuration 282. Now this has to form an ionic bond with another element. So which element can it react with? So let's look at the periodic table. We know for an ionic compound formation, one atom should have a very low ionization potential, low electron affinity and low electronegativity. Since magnesium is in group 2, it's a metal, so it satisfies these conditions. Now the other atom should have a very large electronegativity, very high value of electron affinity, and it should also have a high ionization potential. So if you look in the same period, we know from left to right, all these three quantities increase, and so magnesium can enter an ionic compound formation with chlorine. Since the two have a large difference of the three parameters, magnesium can form an ionic bond with chlorine. So let's see how this takes place. If this forms a compound magnesium chloride, as magnesium reacts with chlorine, so the electronic configuration of magnesium is 2-8-2 and the electronic configuration of chlorine is 2-8-7. Now in order to have the octate structure, magnesium has to get rid of two electrons, and chlorine, for it to have the octate structure, it needs one extra electron. So if magnesium gives one electron to chlorine, now it will have the electronic configuration 2-8-1, and chlorine will have a stable electronic configuration 2-8-8. But still magnesium is not stable. For magnesium to become stable, it needs one more chlorine atom. So it needs two chlorine atoms which are short of one electron each. So now it gives one electron to one chlorine atom and it gives another electron to the other chlorine atom. By doing this, Mg becomes Mg2+, as it has lost two electrons. Now it has the stable electronic configuration 2-8. And when it gives one electron to each of the chlorine atoms, each of them now have the electronic configuration 2-8-8. And since they gain one electron, they become Cl-. So now we have a positively charged ion and two negatively charged ions. So there's attraction between the two unlike charged ions. They attract each other and they come closer to each other, forming a compound MgCl2. So there is one atom of magnesium and two atoms of chlorine. They form this compound magnesium chloride, which is an ionic compound. This is also represented by simply showing the number of valence electrons. Magnesium has two valence electrons. Cl has seven valence electrons. It gives one electron to one Cl, another electron to another Cl atom. It becomes Mg2+ and 2Cl-. Each chlorine has gained one extra electron, and this is written as MgCl2. So this is an ionic compound formation between magnesium and two chlorine atoms. So this is magnesium chloride. Let's take another example, calcium oxide. Let's look at their position in the periodic table. Calcium belongs to group 2. It is a metal. It has a very low ionization potential. It has low electron affinity and low electronegativity. Oxygen belongs to group 16. It is a non-metal. It has a large electronegativity value. It has a high electron affinity and a high value of ionization potential. So the type of compound formed between calcium and oxygen is ionic compound. Now calcium has 2-8-8-2 electrons and oxygen has 2-6. So the valence shell of oxygen consists of 6 electrons and the valence shell of calcium consists of 2 electrons. In order to satisfy the octet rule, calcium has to get rid of 2 electrons and oxygen needs to gain 2 electrons. So what happens? Calcium gives these 2 extra electrons to oxygen. By doing this, calcium now has 2-8-8 electronic configuration. Since it has lost 2 electrons, it becomes Ca2+. Oxygen has gained 2 electrons, it becomes 2,8, and since it has gained 2 electrons, it becomes O2-. So now both of them have the stable electronic configuration. Since they have unlike charges, they attract each other. They form a compound which is known as CaO. That is one atom of calcium, one atom of oxygen, and this is an ionic compound. This can also be represented by showing the number of valence electrons. So we write the chemical, we show the number of valence electrons. So this has 2 valence electrons. Oxygen has 6 valence electrons. It gives the 2 valence electrons to oxygen. It becomes Ca2+, O2-, which we can also write as CaO. So this is calcium oxide. Since one atom loses electrons, other atom gains electrons, this compound is an ionic or an electrovalent compound. So the type of compounds, that is ionic compounds, they are the chemical compounds formed as a result of transfer of electrons. That is, one atom loses electrons and the other atom gains electrons.